scotch and one bill. One bourbon, one scotch and one bill.
G'day guys, Robbie from Travelling Whisky Reviews again. As I've been promising you all week, we are here with Whisky Royalty. I've got the Honourable Alex Bruce, Master of the Quake, from Ardnamurchan and Adelphi fame. Alex, thank you so much.
Robbie, thank you very much.
Alex, we'll just jump into it. Yeah. You have been, you've had a deep history in whisky, driven by your family. You're a Master of the Quake, and your father was instrumental in the setting up of the Keepers of the Quake. What I would like to know is how your family drove you into whisky.
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, they do sometimes say that whisky is in the blood, whether you put it there yourself or whether it's just there. I suppose we look at it from the two different sides. My father was certainly asked to contribute to setting up the Keepers of the Quake. So this is, what, early 80s, mid-80s. It was founded really for two main reasons. To thank people all over the world who had been influential in getting people to enjoy Scotch whisky. Whether they be a retailer, or a brand ambassador, or just about anyone anywhere who had an involvement. So to thank them, but also to bring them to Scotland and show them some real traditional Scottish hospitality. So my father went to the inaugural dinner, I believe, anyway, and he was asked for feedback. And he said that was great, it's proper Scotland, you know, it's a banquet, it's a beautiful castle, but it's missing the fun. In Scotland, we don't take things too seriously, but we don't like to do it. And he proposed that they introduce a song at the end of the banquet, which I can't tell you too much about, but it was enjoyed not by just by the Scots, but by the visitors, because it involves some movement. And certainly after a few drams, it flowed quite easily. And I mean, over the years, they've had some guest speakers, including Ronald Reagan, they've had Princess Anne, and without fail, they've all joined in at this point. It's all part of this hospitality. And on the other side of the family, my mother's maiden name is Usher, and my four times great-grandfather is Andrew Usher. And Andrew Usher Sr. was credited with developing and pioneering consistent blended Scotch whisky. Mm. So taking it from the grocery level to an international blend.
Yeah. What a pedigree.
Well, as I say, whisky in the blood, whether you put it there or not.
Alex, Adelphi has been renowned as a discerning independent bottler with significant growth in the IB market. How has it changed Adelphi's cask management, and is it more difficult to acquire cask now than say in the 90s and the 2000s?
So there's quite a few different things there. I mean, first of all, independent bottlers, you can take that as a category. You've got to remember that way back when there was just a few of them, they were more prevalent, if you like, the reason for them to be there was more as a licensed bottler for distillers. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't that long ago, I mean, we're talking 1979, 1980, when Macallan actually launched its own first single malt. Mm-hmm. And prior to that, Macallan and a number of other distillers had licensed to the likes of Gordon Fail to bottle their whisky as single malt. Mm-hmm. So really, the IB category was formed on single malt as a category, as well as blended, but single malt was the one. And that is where the difference has occurred over the years. Single malt is now a very quick, accelerating category. Really, since the early 2000s, it's recognized globally as a hugely important drink. We have GI status now for it. And yes, there are a huge amount more independent bottlers than there ever were. But we've got to remember it's the category we're involved with rather than the national independent bottlers. that has changed the industry. So in terms of the supply, so we've got demand way up. Supply, we noticed, certainly as Adelphi, we noticed supply beginning to get harder around the mid-2000s, so between 2000 and 2010. We could still get stock, but it was harder to get diversity stock. And unlike the original players, we never filled new make spirit. We always bought just-in-time mature stock. So, what we've done differently in recent years, as we've grown, well, two things. One is, we had to secure our future in terms of quality and quantity. And the only way to do that is actually make it yourself. So that's the distillery, and we can offer that. And secondly, we started to buy larger parcels of mature stock, when available, and select from within that parcel. So even though we own it, and there is some risk involved in the cars that we don't necessarily want to keep, we know that given the demand that we have as an industry, we can trade off any casks that we don't want or aren't suitable for us and get bored. Mm-hmm. So in fact, the trading stock is just as valuable as the stuff.
Yeah, of course. Fantastic. And now you've mentioned it, Ardnamurchan. So really with the founding of Ardnamurchan, the building of Ardnamurchan, Adelphi has really now come full circle, I would put it. When you look back and reflect on where you are now, is there a sense that you've achieved the goal that you started out to, or where to from here?
I mean, we've certainly climbed a few rungs on the ladder.
Yeah.
In terms of the goal, you can never sit back and say that's it.
Yeah.
One day I might be retired with my slippers on, a pipe in hand, sipping a mature Ardnamurchan, and at that point I might feel content.
Mm.
But look, yes, we've kind of come a full circle. If you take it right back to the original Adelphi Distillery in Glasgow, and there was a connection between the two companies originally, yes, we're back to distilling, but this time it's for a very different reason. We're there to produce our own single malt, a coastal Highland single malt. We want to be very true to that. And I really, you know, we're being patient about releasing it, but I will feel that we've certainly reached somewhere near A goal when the product is on the market as a single malt.
Of course. Ardnamurchan to me is incredibly progressive in regards to the sustainability factor that you've done in the building. So environmentally, your environmental duty of care, your energy efficiency, sustainability. How do you think that side of things will impact on the final product?
In terms of flavour, it shouldn't affect it too much, apart from the fact that we are trying to do everything in one place.
Mm.
So I'm a great believer in maturing. If you have a good maturation climate, use it.
Yeah.
Don't just because it's cheaper to store palletized in a dry warehouse.
Yeah.
In the central belt. If you're looking for a unique single malt product and you've got that lovely damp west coast, then use it.
Yeah.
So that end of it, and the quality of the water, the peaty water up there, we're certainly trying to use our local raw materials as best as we can,
mm-hmm.
put it that way. The sustainability angle, we're very aware the way things are going in general in the world. We don't want to, by building a new plant, if you want to call it that, or industry, in a very remote, special area of Scotland. We don't want to affect it adversely in any way, quite the opposite. And it's not just about protecting the environment, it's also about protecting the local economy, or enhancing it even. And it's very important for us to have this kind of circular, symbiotic relationship with our local economy, not just with trading, which is buying the wood chip, which is manufactured there, and the jobs that go into that, or giving the byproducts back, feeding the farm, the animals, but also about future employment of our own, about creating jobs in the area, about sustaining young people and so they didn't have to go off and work in the city, they could stay where they grew up.
Yeah.
So there's a lot going on within this kind of symbiotic approach.
Now you touched on your peak there in the coastal islands. You're producing both peated and unpeated in both ex bourbon and ex sherry maturation. Is that correct? And out of these combinations of that you can get out of this, is there any standout for you? What should we be looking for?
So I mean, we're coming up for our fifth year. We're obviously beginning to monitor the maturation quite closely.
Mm-hmm.
And if you'd asked me that 6 months ago, I would have said European, or in our case, Spanish oak, Oloroso, peated.
Oh, yeah.
Now, just before I came out, I picked a few samples from some casks to bring to this, tastings around New Zealand and Australia. And for the first time, I looked at some of the bourbon casks properly.
Mm-hmm.
And I picked out a 2015 unpeated ex-bourbon barrel. And it's just the butterfly has flown just in the last few months. And that really excites me because we're now, as I say, we're approaching our fifth year. We are still being patient in terms of releasing, but we are really happy that all the different components are coming together nicely.
Mm-hmm. And from my calculations, I'm thinking 2021. Is that what we're thinking about for the first release?
So it should be globally available, certainly by the beginning of 2021. We are aiming to release it almost planned around October 2020.
Okay.
And then by the time it's shipped to various countries, it may be Christmas if we're lucky.
Well, you remember me on your Christmas card this now, I hope. But back to the Adelphi side of things.
Yeah.
There's been so many incredible Adelphi expressions. I've been lucky enough to own some, not as much as I would like. Hopefully I can change that tonight. Is there any one particular Adelphi expression that stands out in your mind? Or if not, a distillery, which is sort of...
I mean, I suppose in terms of when I've been involved, so since 2004, one of the most interesting brands I've ever tasted, and I'm going to be fortunate enough to bottle, was a single blend from Noxa from 1965, I think. I remember that. So a single blend sounds really weird. What it is, there were a number of distilleries in those days, well, two in particular, owned by a Canadian, Joseph Hopps. And one of those was Ben Nevis, the other one was Loxa. He was quite entrepreneurial, and he developed the idea of distilling both grain whiskey and malt whiskey under the same roof, so one distillery, and blending at birth the two components. So a single blend Loxa, with Loxa grain and malt blended at birth.
Yes.
We don't know what the portions
is,
but after than it was 40-odd years in the cask. It was delicious.
Wow.
So that would be my standout in terms of point of difference.
Yeah.
And just to finish that off, our average hit, if you like, our ratio of what we select and what we taste, it varies year on year. It's somewhere between 1 and 30, 1 and 40 casks selected. But there have been some anomalies in there. To take two off the top of my head, Kleinwiesch and Kulida have shown a very high rate of consistency and quality.
You said that the grain, single grain blend, there's no ratio. Is there not a stock ledger that we can see, we can find somewhere we can get our hands on?
Not that we're aware of. I had a kind of really almost grain moment a couple of years ago. A Canadian lady who came to see us in Scotland. We've done some things with her in the past. Her father had owned a lot of this stock, which he bought from Joseph Hogg. And sadly, her father had died, and she'd been left with tidying up the house. And as she was tidying up, she discovered paperwork showing that he owned, I think, 20 casks or lots of single blend. And she asked me to find them.
Yeah.
And I went back, I went to the people who bought the distillery, because it's locked down, it's a car park, it's locked down. We tried every single avenue, and it's great. Oh, it's beautiful.
Well, that's unbelievable. Anyway, we can dream.
Yeah.
Adelphi's known for pioneering the fusion malt category, as recognised by the Scotch Whisky Association, the FWA, and an initiative which you personally drive?
Yeah. So just on that, recognise probably isn't quite the right word. We had to obviously include or discuss with the Scotch Whisky Association. They're an incredibly important body who maintain the very strict and protective laws around Scotch Whisky, which we are really lucky to have. But when you've got a new idea like this fusion project, which is basically an international blend, so Scotch plus something else, you have to make sure that you're not pushing your boundaries too much, which could then adversely affect the rest of the industry. So I engaged with the association. My original question, I think, related to what we call the glove up, which was a Japanese Scotch. And I asked them, can we blend Japanese and Scotch whiskies in Scotland? And they immediately said no, and referred me to the Scotch Whisky Act, which says you're only allowed to produce Scotch whisky in Scotland. Anyway, we found a way around it, which they were more than happy for us to do. And it's been a really interesting few years, actually. We've certainly highlighted the lives of a number of great Scots who were very influential in other countries, with whom we have been to highlight their lives.
You've made many trips here to Australia, as we discussed earlier, and to our cousins, New Zealand, as you just, you've got here just from there. Can you tell us a bit about how or what changes and advances you've seen in the Australian market and consumers? Because I've seen it, even in my short time involved in the industry, how greatly it's changed.
In terms of the independent bottling presence, we have a huge amount of knowledge in both markets now. Albeit this is increasing globally as well, but especially out here, you can see by the amount of bars that now stock independent bottling, single cask bottles, they wouldn't do that unless it was demand. And that demand is coming from education. It's not just us, it's Diageo, it's Benarica, it's the guys who own a lot of these distilleries, getting people into whisky in the first place. And then, as with anything in life, once you're into something, you want to keep that interest up, you want to keep looking, trying out new expressions and all the rest of it. So, certainly, I've seen a huge development in both markets. And a younger age, or a younger demographic, a far better, or more even male female split. And a real interest in the story, the provenance behind the traceability, the transparency. All of this is part of our new generation of interested whisky makers.
Fantastic. Well, we love having you here, and thank you. So, and that'll bring me to just thanking you from the bottom of our hearts here at TWR for giving us some time and sitting down with us. We truly look forward to the future of both Adelphi and Ardnamurchan. And like I said, hit me on that Christmas card list, okay, when it's coming out next year. Thank you for giving us your time.
Very well.
One bourbon, one scotch, and one bill. One bourbon.